At the annual company picnic, the advertising department always played a game of softball with the editorial department. It was for bragging rights for an entire year. This particular year, the advertising department won 9 runs to 4 runs. They were really living it up at the company picnic, boasting about how great they were and how that they had beaten the editorial department. However, when the advertising department came into work on Monday morning, they found the following notice. The editorial department is proud to announce that upon the conclusion of this year's softball tournament, we, the editorial department, finished in 2nd place overall, having only lost 1 game the entire season. We would also like to take this opportunity to offer our condolences to the advertising department's team for finishing next to last, having won only 1 game during the entire year. It's amazing how with a little bit of different wording, the outcome can sound so differently, isn't it? Book of Joshua is about victories under the leadership of Joshua. Time after time, Israel was being led by Joshua, who was following God. And Israel defeated strong armies. They defeated fortified cities. They conquered a lot of land. They took possessions of what God gave to them. But the book of Judges, Joshua has died. And throughout the book of Judges, we're going to see that Israel's being offered the choice to follow God or do things your own way. I've entitled this new series of sermons, What Do You Choose? Who Do You Choose? Because that is the choice that's being given to Israel time and time and time again. And Joshua made the decision while he was still alive, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. But now that Joshua is dead and no longer the leader, we get to see who or what they choose to follow time and time again. So we're going to start this new series starting here in Judges chapter 1. But as usual, I want to start first with prayer. Lord, I'm so thankful for your love. I'm so thankful for your blessings. And I ask, Lord, that you would help us to consider the victories that were there and the non-victories. Help us to understand the fact that if we follow you, we can have victory. But if we try to do things our own way, we're going to see failure. Lord, help us as we study through the book of Judges that we see this over and over and we make a decision for our own household. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. What will we choose to follow? Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. There are 3 main thoughts I want to get across today as I go through Judges 1. The first comes from the first 15 verses, and I'm going to call it the start of victories. The start of victories. Let me begin by reading the first couple of verses here. Now it came about after the death of Joshua that the sons of Israel inquired of the Lord, saying, "Who shall go up first for us against the Canaanites to fight against them?" The Lord said, "Judah shall go up. Behold, I have given the land into his hand." That's a great start for this book. Joshua has died, and the very first thing we see is that the Israelites are inquiring of the Lord as to how do we proceed from this point forward? How do we go against the Canaanites? And right here, they're making a very wise choice. When Moses led the Israelites, Moses showed them how to inquire the Lord. They would go to the high priest. The high priest had the Urim and the Thummim on their shoulders, and they used to inquire of the Lord so many different things. And when Joshua took over leading the Israelites, he too would inquire of the Lord, what was God's plan? What was God's plan for the battle? And whenever he followed that plan, like when they went against the city of Jericho, and he followed the plan that you're going to march around the city, march around the city, march around the city, and on the 7th day, blow the trumpets after the 7th time going around, and God answered, and God brought the city down, and they were able to have great victories. God answered them. And here, Israel, after Joshua's died, they inquire of the Lord, how do we go about this? And God said, Judah shall go up against the Canaanites. So straightforward. How hard is that to understand? I don't think it's hard at all. Judah is the one that's going further, going forward. But let me read a little further. Verses 3 through 15. So they inquired of the Lord, and they received the command for Judah to go first. Now let's read, starting in verse 3. Then Judah said to Simeon, his brother, Come up with me into the territory allotted me, that we may fight against the Canaanites, and I in turn will go with you into the territory allotted to you. So Simeon went with him. Judah went up, and the Lord gave the Canaanites and the Perizzites into their hands, and they defeated 10,000 men at Bezek. They found Adoni Bezek and Bezek and fought against him, and they defeated the Canaanites and the Perizzites. But Adoni Bezek fled, and they pursued him and caught him and cut off his thumbs and his big toes. Adoni Bezek said, 70 kings with their thumbs and their big toes cut off used to gather up the scraps under my table. As I have done, the Lord has repaid me. So they brought him to Jerusalem, and he died there. Then the sons of Judah fought against Jerusalem and captured it and struck it with the edge of the sword and set the city to fire. Afterward, the sons of Judah went down to fight against the Canaanites, living in the hill country and in the Negev and in the lowland. So Judah went against the Canaanites who lived in Hebron. Now the name of Hebron formerly was Kiriath Arba. And they struck Sheshah and Ahiman and Talmai. Great names. Pay attention to them, though. They're very important people. From there they went into the inhabitants of Debir. Now the name of Debir formerly was Kiriath Sefer. And Caleb said, "The one who attacks Kiriath Sefer and captures it, I will even give him my daughter Achsah for a wife." Othniel, the son of Kenaz, Caleb's younger brother, captured it. So he gave him his daughter Achsah as a wife. And then it came about when she came to him that she persuaded him to ask her father for a field. Then she alighted from her donkey, and Caleb said to her, "What do you want?" She said to him, "Give me a blessing, since you have given me into the land. Since you have given me the land of the Negev, give me also the springs of water." So Caleb gave her the upper springs and the lower springs. Now remember, they inquired of the Lord, and God said, "Who's supposed to go up first? Judah." How hard is that to remember? Who's going first? Judah. What's the very first thing Judah does? "Hey, Simeon, let's go." Was that part of the answer from God? No. The answer from God was Judah's supposed to go up. But the very first thing Judah wants to do, and the Israelites, let's modify the Lord's commandment. We can modify it. What does it matter? God didn't say send Judah and Simeon. He said send Judah. And the people of Judah said, "Well, you know what? God probably doesn't know what he's talking about. We better fix this, and we better do it better. We got a better plan. Simeon, why don't you come with us?" And they recruited him. In a way, I can't really blame them, because Judah was being sent into the fortified cities of the Canaanites, and he was being sent there to go wipe them out. A little help sounds reasonable. Whenever I have a big task in front of me, I'm always willing to have a little help. I'm not always willing to ask for a little bit of help, but I am willing to have a little bit of help. And later on in this book, we're going to discover that God doesn't need a huge army to have a victory against a huge army. And if people would just trust the Lord, God can save with a few. Perhaps God was trying to teach the Israelites right here, "Look, trust me. You don't need all 12 tribes. Just one tribe. We'll go in there and we'll wipe a whole bunch out." He was trying to get them to see that his great power, how that he can drive out the nations before him. They don't need to trust in their power. Trust in God. But Judah, "Hey, Simeon, let's go together. Perhaps our tribes can do this." It's funny that God worked through them anyway. The people of the tribes of Judah and Simeon, they attacked. They defeated thousands of Canaanites and Perizzites. But one thing they did wrong. They pursued Adoni Bezek. They caught him. They cut off his thumbs and his big toes, and they kept him alive. But God's initial command way back in Deuteronomy chapter 20, verses 16 through 18, that's why I put that up there, just in case you didn't remember. "Only in the cities of these peoples that the Lord your God is giving you as an inheritance, you shall not leave any alive anything that breathes." Anything that breathes. "You shall utterly destroy them, the Hittite and the Amorite, the Canaanite and the Perizzite, the Hivite and the Jebusite, as the Lord your God has commanded you, so that they may not teach you to do according to all their detestable things which they have done for their gods, so that you would not sin against the Lord your God." So they had been commanded, when you go into this promised land, you just slay every one of them so they don't influence you to start worshiping their gods. Yet right away, Judah, being told by God, you go first. Hey, let's modify this. Simeon, you come with me. We're supposed to go in and attack these cities. We're supposed to slay everybody. Well, let's keep this guy alive. We'll cut off his thumbs. We'll cut off his big toes. We can modify God's word. What's the problem? The funny thing is, Adonai Bezek looked at it and go, well, this must be God's punishment against me. I've done this to 70 other kings, and now I'm doing this. But you know what? That wasn't God's punishment. That was Simeon and Judah's. God had told him, no. I said, I want you to destroy them so they don't lead you into the sin of worshiping their other gods. Later on, when King Saul is leading, he spares a king and a whole bunch of livestock. When God gave orders to them to go in there and slay them all, and yet King Saul decides to keep them and keep a bunch of livestock, and he sends the prophet Samuel to him and says, to obey is better than sacrifice, to heed is better than the fat of rams. And Samuel continued on saying that God has removed King Saul from being king because of his insubordination, his modification of God's commands. Because God takes his commands very seriously. And he doesn't want us to change his commands. Yet God let Judah and Simeon win some of the battles when they rose up against the Canaanites. But as you keep reading in Judges chapter 1, we read of more and more compromises and limited victories. In verse 16, we read, the descendants of the Kenite, Moses' father-in-law, went up from the city of palms with the sons of Judah to the wilderness of Judah, which is in the south of Arad. And they went and they lived with the people. Wait, what was God's command? Kill them all. Well, let's just live with them. The Kenites basically decided, oh, let's not drive out the Canaanites. Let's just live among them. This will be fine. So we got the Kenites making their compromise. Granted, the Kenites weren't actually descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Remember, they had married into the family of the Israelites, and Moses' wife was a Kenite. Her father was that. But they have traveled with the Israelites. They have been blessed by God. They were living among the Israelites. But instead of obeying God's command to drive out the Canaanites, they chose to just live among them. I don't care whether they would do this. I don't care if they worship other gods. So what? We all get along. Let's just exist together. Everything will be fine. It caused problems. Verses 17 through 20. And kind of a recap of the earlier verses is about Judah and Simeon. Then Judah went with Simeon, his brother, and they struck the Canaanites living in Zephah, and they utterly destroyed it. So the name of that city was called Hormah. And Judah took Gaza with its territory, and Ashkelon with its territory, and Ekron with its territory. Now the Lord was with Judah, and they took possession of the hill country. But they could not drive out the inhabitants of the valley because they had iron chariots. Then they gave Hebron to Caleb, as Moses had promised, and he drove out from there the three sons of Anak. What I find interesting here is that same name, just a few verses earlier, we read about how Judah has failed in driving out the inhabitants, the Canaanites, due to the excuse, well, they had iron chariots. The writer has also told us that Judah was able to drive out the three sons of Anak. Remember when I was reading along, I got to verse 10 and I said three names. I said, remember these guys. These are kind of important. Shisha, Amon, and Talma. To all of you guys, you were probably going, well, those are just names. Those guys are very important because they are the sons of Anak. And Anak, if you remember in your Old Testament history, was the father of the giants. So Judah has already gone in and has confessed, we have already gone in there and we've killed the giants. We could conquer them. They were easy. God was with us. But these people, well, they got iron chariots. Well, we can't possibly try that. Wait a minute. God helped Judah and Simeon defeat gigantic men, and then they couldn't go defeat some people with iron chariots. Was it just easier to put up with them than to try and listen to God and defeat them? I wonder that, especially as you keep reading in the book of Judges. Verse 21 states, but the sons of Benjamin, did not drive out the Jebusites who lived in Jerusalem. So the Jebusites have lived with the sons of Benjamin in Jerusalem to this day. Benjamin! He didn't drive out the Jebusites, despite the fact the Lord says, I'm going to fight for you. I'll go before you. I will drive them out. Nah, this is too hard. We'll just let them be there. For Benjamin, it was apparently easier just to live among the Jebusites, live alongside of them. Verses 22 through 29, we read about the sons of Joseph, Manasseh and Ephraim. The sons of Joseph, likewise, the house of Joseph went up against Bethel, and the Lord was with them. The house of Joseph spied out Bethel. Now the name of the city was formerly Luz. The spies saw a man coming out of the city. They said to him, please show us the entrance of the city, and we will treat you kindly. So he showed them the entrance of the city, and they struck the city with the edge of the sword, but they let the man and all of his family go free. The man went into the land of the Hittites and built a city and named it Luz, which is to this its name to this day. But Manasseh did not take possession of Beth Shean and its villages, or Taanach and its villages, or the inhabitants of Dor and its villages, or the inhabitants of Ibleam or its villages, or the inhabitants of Megiddo and its villages. So the Canaanites persisted in living in that land. It came about when Israel became strong that they put the Canaanites to forced labor, but they did not drive them out completely. Ephraim did not drive out the Canaanites who were living in Gezer, so the Canaanites lived in Gezer among them. Right away, we read the story of the victory for the sons of Joseph against Bethel or Luz. But after we read of that victory, we read about Manasseh. Ah, we didn't take possession of those cities. No, we didn't drive them out of those cities. We just left them there. Let the Canaanites live among us. Later on, the people of Manasseh grew stronger. They could have driven them out. Nah, it's nice to have them here. Let's just make them into slaves and servants for us. This is good. We can live among them. I know what God said. He said to slay them all, but nah, this is so much easier, so much better. And his brother did the same thing with Ephraim. Although God commanded the Israelites to drive out and destroy the Canaanites so they don't influence you to worship their gods, tribe after tribe would battle so far, and then they'd go, nah, we'll just let them dwell among us. We're fine. Not realizing what a snare they would become for them. We read the same thing in verse 30 about Zebulun. Zebulun did not drive out the inhabitants of Kitron, or the inhabitants of Nahal, nor the Canaanites. So the Canaanites lived among them and became subject to forced labor. Why obey God? Let's just let the Canaanites live among us. Let them become our slaves. Same thing happened in Asher and Naphtali, verses 31 through verse 33. Asher did not drive out the inhabitants of Akko, or the inhabitants of Sidon, or Elab, or Akzib, or Helba, or the Aphek, or Rahab. So the Asherites lived among the Canaanites and the inhabitants of the land, for they did not drive them out. Naphtali did not drive out the inhabitants of Beth Shemesh, or the inhabitants of Beth Anath, but lived among the Canaanites, the inhabitants of the land, and the inhabitants of Beth Shemesh, and then Beth Anath became forced labor for them. It seems like all of the tribes seem to be very content. I know what God said, but let's modify that. Let's change God's command. Let's not destroy the Canaanites. Let's let them live among us as long as they're willing to help us and be our slaves. Free labor. Even the Danites. The tribe of Dan, verses 34 through 36. Didn't do something right. There we go. Dan. Then the Amorites forced the sons of Dan into the hill country, for they did not allow them to come down the valley. Yet the Amorites persisted in living in Mount Heres, in Ajalon, in Shalbim. And then when the power of the house of Joseph grew strong, they became forced labor. The border of the Amorites ran from the ascent of Akarabim, from Selah and upward. Well, why? Why isn't Israel winning many of these battles in Judges chapter 1? What's going on? Well, if you keep reading in the book of Judges, you're going to find out the major problem was they quit listening to God. And they stopped attempting to obey God's commands, and they started leaning simply on their own power, their own wisdom, their own strength, when they should have been listening to God the entire time. Because under Joshua, they had many victories. Some of those victories seemed absolutely impossible. When Israel went up against fortified cities with huge armies, Israel was sometimes absolutely outnumbered. Even later on in the book of Judges, even in 1 and 2 Samuel and 1 and 2 Kings, we're going to read about times when the Israelites would not have stood a chance, humanly speaking, of possibly winning. I mean, they would be outnumbered 2-1, 3-1, 5-1, hundreds to one. The other army would be well equipped with all kinds of weapons and swords and spears and shields. They would have horses and chariots of iron. Wow, that was an excuse we already heard. But they're going to go up against chariots of iron and horses. They're going to run across with the weapons of war that would be catapults and other things that the other enemy would have. In Israel, remember one of those battles? Remember the one with Saul and Jonathan and they're getting ready to go in battle? You know how many swords they had? Two. Saul's and Jonathan's. Woohoo! We're going against this huge army. What's the chance of winning? You know, when they were following God, they were winning. When they trusted God, they would win. And people like Joshua could lead them in victory. People like David could lead them in victory. People like Jonathan, remember? And Jared preached a sermon one time where they crawled down in the crag and they climbed up the other side. And remember, by hands and feet, they're climbing up. And Jonathan with his armor bearer. They've got one sword. They're going against the Philistine army. Humongous army. They got one sword and they're climbing up. Here's the battle plan. If they say, come on up, we'll go on up, we'll slaughter them. If they say, stay there, they're going to come down and slaughter us. Great battle plan, let's go for it. They trusted God and they were able to win and defeat the Philistines that day because they listened to God. It starts with listening to God and being obedient to God and to His commands. But we see right away here in the book of Judges, Judges chapter 1, their victories were limited when they stopped listening to God and they began relying upon their own strength. Oh, they might win a battle or two against a few cities, but then they'd lose and they'd give up. Or they'd prefer just to live among those people. I don't care. They got their gods, we got our gods. We would intermarry and then pretty soon we're all worshiping all kinds of weird gods. Even under Joshua, the Israelites discovered this. Remember after they defeated the powerful city, the fortified city, the walled city of Jericho? The very next city they were going to was a short name, Ai. And they were going to and they said, man, this is going to be a piece of cake. Let's only use 3,000 people. We can whip them easily with 3,000 people. They lose. They try it again. They lose. They ask God, what's going on? Well, you got sin in the camp. You know, when they tried to do it on their own idea, it just wasn't going to work. But when they got rid of the sin, cleansed the sin out of their camp, and then they listened to God, they completely slaughtered Ai. And as you read through Judges with us, and as we go through this whole series of what do you choose, you're going to see the Israelites time and time again experiencing loss because they stopped listening to God. But when they would repent, and I love this, Jared put these things right on there when he put this slide thing together, his introduction. He did a great job getting a whole bunch of the same words I'm using because I bet he read this book before. When they repented, they would win. They would win. When they would turn to follow God, we would see God delivering them time and time again through several different judges that are raised up. And even in this first chapter of Judges, I cannot help but see that God is telling us and teaching us, I want you to listen to and I want you to obey God. Can you imagine the difference this chapter and this book would have been if Israel had simply continued to listen to and obey God from day one? What might have happened if Judah had responded, you know, God, you said for me to go, I'm going. We're going to go. And they would have just gone in there and they would have cleansed that land of all the Canaanites. I believe they would have had victory after victory after victory because they were obeying God and not saying, hey, you know what, this is like a big battle. Simeon, can you come? And when they get into battle and they're winning, well, let's keep this guy. He's a king. We'll humiliate him by cutting off his thumbs and his toes. Instead, We see limited victories because he let some people live just to torture them. We can't do things just our own way. We need to listen to God. How different could this chapter, how different could this book be if every tribe had just simply taken God's word at his word and obeyed his word? I believe that that's what we're being called to do. And I want you to keep reading this book. And as we go through this book, I want you to read through this book several different times. I want you to see, as you read through there, what happened when they were disobedient. How disobedience could become a snare when they let these people live and they had all their false gods. How did that become a snare? How did that become a test to them? And see this. That when we dwell ourselves and we think, oh, I can resist all these temptations. I can live among all kinds of temptations. I will be able to resist. I am such a good, strong Christian. I don't need any extra help. We're going to be falling. We need to listen to God, trust Him, obey Him. We need to be people who sit there and go, I need the full armor of God. I need to do what God says and not try to change His word. Let's do what He calls us to do. I thank you, Lord, for your love. I thank you, Lord, for this book. And as we start this series of sermons about what do you choose? Who do you choose? Help us to see that as we look at the Israelites, the problems they ran into when they chose to follow their own ideas, to modify your word. Lord, help us to see the problems they ran into. And Lord, help us to realize how that they could have great victory when they repented and came back to you and listened to you and followed what you called them to do. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.